welcome to Feels Like Weezer, where we're discussing the band Weezer and all its track-by-track, song-by-song goodness, one track and one song at a time. I'm Eric Nash from Watchmen Minute.
And I'm Zach Franking-Smith. You can follow me on Twitter at The Informal Log. And today we have a guest. To my right is...
Hi, I'm Alice Lauren. I am from upstate New York. And my Twitter is AliMezh, A-L-I-M-E-Z-H.
Welcome to the show, Alice.
Thank you for having me.
Well, you know, thanks for answering our frantic Facebook post for
of course.
So, what are we talking about today, Eric?
We are talking about the third track off of Pinkerton, but it's our fourth one that we're covering so far. No other one.
So this is the last one we're doing?
Right. There is no other one after this.
Oh, there's no other one.
Our final show.
Got it.
Only three tracks on this album.
it's the best. Wonderful. So
Zach would have preferred it that way, but not these three songs, I don't think.
Well, the latter half of the album is much better. Is
generally considered, yeah.
You know. So what'd you think of the song, Alice?
Well... Interestingly enough, I am not really a Weezer fan, and I've never heard this song until like an hour ago. And I'm not the biggest fan. I gotta be honest, I'm not the biggest fan. That guitar just, it felt like a root canal for my ears. I think I might rather get like a colonoscopy, just like fully awake, rather than really listen to that again. To be honest, you know.
I get it.
Typical fan. I tried to grade it on the sound and then also grade it, you know, really look at the lyrics as well. And the lyrics definitely spoke to me, you know, in a different way. I think they were still very simplistic, which I wasn't, you know, necessarily a fan of in this. You know, I mean, you can have simplistic lyrics maybe in more of like a rap track or, you know, something like that, you know. But in this, I don't know if I would prefer simplistic stuff. But it, you know, it definitely spoke to me in like a very, you know, some very scary themes, you know, of this kind of like overbearing boyfriend. So it was interesting to kind of have those lyrics. I kind of went instantly into covers, which I know we'll talk about later, but to kind of get some more covers to kind of bring those lyrics out more.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah. And that's something I, for the first time, listened to earlier today and doing my little bit of research for this song, is something I'd point you to, Alice, to listen to is find the leader of the band, essentially, mm-hmm. Rivers Cuomo, doing the song acoustically live. It is, you know, so it's definitely, as far as its general arrangement, it's just him. It's not all these other crazy things he's got going on. They got going on as far as their distorted guitars and so forth sounding in certain interesting ways that they were trying to do back then.
Well, in this album especially, like, I feel like this album is not indicative of what Weezer is just in general. You know, it's a very far cry from the Blue album previously, you know, with like Buddy Holly and Say It Ain't So and all that stuff. You know, and you kind of echo what all Weezer fans think, which is Weezer sucks, but we still love them. You know, that's one of my sister. She was talking to my niece and she was like, you know, oh, you want to hurt Uncle Zach's feelings. Just say Weezer sucks. And I'm like, I know. Are you kidding me? I mean, I like this song, so much better than the last one, that's for sure. Get You is not. I mean, and this song, I think, is a really good next part to Get You. You know, it's still got that same, like, I wouldn't say violence to it, but, you know, it's almost kind of flipped on its head to where Get You was more of the man being possessive, and then this one is more Rivers is kind of fearing the relationship that he's in.
In general, like I was saying, I mean, I think I agree that the lyrics are where it kind of shines a bit. The general kind of sound it has, and I think also it's just its melody though too. The sound it has these elements that are kind of crazy, some certain distortion going on throughout, but like the melody especially has this, to me it's like this old timey feel.
Mm-hmm.
Now they had the B-sides, they had the one that's the more like the barbershop quartet, you know.
You mean the best song
instruments on it
on the album.
The one that you really liked, and I think it certainly is, it's not that old timey, but it's getting close to that, it's closer to that, this melody that's going on, it's close to a drone kind of, but
yeah, and drone would be probably a good word for that, kind of like it didn't match the lyrics, I would say. It was like distortion, but also distorted from kind of what the story that like he's telling.
Yeah, like you guys have been saying, the lyrics I feel like are where they really shine, you know, when I can actually understand it. You know, Pinkerton is Mumbleton, you know, that's kind of what I view it as, especially that second verse, the all of the drugs she does scare me real good.
Yeah.
Like I get that part, and then the next two lines, she's got a tattoo and two pet snakes. I always thought that was she's got a tattoo and two left sleeves. So,
oh my god. So she's not all right. So that's
I like you a lot and I really appreciate that. So thank you for listening to the podcast. We're gonna shut it down because that was the best joke. Nobody's ever gonna top it. So
no.
There's nothing left for us. That's
not all right.
But yeah, no, but two pet snakes, that would terrify me too. Like I'm right on board, Rivers. Like I'm not a big snake guy. So, but overall, you know, it is a pretty basic love song, but I feel like it kind of twisted on its head to where instead of it being so, you know, like mushy gushy, lovey lovey, it's more, you know, like I'm recognizing there are problems, but you are still the one for me, you know? So in that way, I feel like it's a more realistic love track.
Yeah, and I think that two pet snakes line kind of comes out of nowhere too. It's like it's just there's like kind of offbeat, I guess. I don't know. It reminded me sort of. I just googled it. This, I don't know if you know, like Hobo Johnson or these like kind of mumble rappers. Not that I want to say that Rivers Cuomo is a mumble rapper or anything, but kind of the SoundCloud, you know, mumble rapping kind of thing. If this was a rap, it would just be completely off base, like someone who was just trying to make something rhyme, and it just did not pan out.
Yep.
Well, the mumble rap is more pretty recent, I think. Like maybe last 5 or 10 years. I mean, this is a 20 plus, 25 almost, about year old song. And back then, I mean, we were just talking a couple episodes about Nirvana and Weird Al, even with his his song of theirs. These mumble rappers maybe could have, maybe not directly, but indirectly, you know, maybe there's something else that I'm not aware of where some mumbling was pretty big.
Well, I mean, influenced a lot by grunge, I think. Mm-hmm. I think grunge music just in general, you know, where you've got that, you have these societal questions, you know, that they're trying to get through, like especially with Smells Like Teen Spirit, you know, and with this, you know, it's more personal, but you know, I think that the grunge movement is probably a pretty big influence on just mumbling and songs in general, except for the hey, whatever that one was, ZZ Top, they're just mumbling through the whole thing. So I just have to point out here this song was released in 1996, so I am older than this song, so now I feel.
I can't believe that they've been around this long. I'm like, oh, they're still new. You know, when I was a kid, like, I heard the song Beverly right. Hills, you know, I'm like, oh, new, yeah. You know, like Fall Out Boy, you know, like, new band, you know. So it's interesting to hear that.
It seems to me like Weezer are a band that can kind of, you know, come back, can make a couple albums, yeah. Kind of maybe with the second one,
trash album. Being
a ratitude. But then the next one, I mean, they kind of, you know, get something going again, get some mm-hmm. you know, some relevance more to,
yes, absolutely,
youth culture as it has evolved a little bit, yeah. And can find their feet again. And
well, and that's, you know, I think Weezer does a really good job of, you know, tapping into what the kids like these days, what the utes like these days. But you know, because now I'm apparently an old fogey, thanks Tyler. But 27, shut up. And they do kind of have that livability, and a lot of their, especially their early stuff, I'm thinking Blue and Green specifically, they're kind of timeless, you know. You got your Buddy Hollies and your Say It Ain't So, because what they really have going for them is not only the music, but Rivers' lyricism is just incredible. You know, especially in those two. This one, it's hit and miss. They have staying power, and there's a reason for that. Weezer is my favorite, least favorite band. You know, it depends on which album it is. Beverly Hills and Perfect Situation, those were like the two first like really big ones that everybody in my high school was like freaking out about. So, so Alice, tell us a little bit why you didn't like the music. Cause I'm interested. I think that this song, I like the music in this song personally. I think it's a good, I think it's a good softer break from Get You. So I'm just kind of interested, why, how much blood was coming out of your ears, you know, and why?
Yeah, well, I just heard that sex one too, so it was like right that after that one, so it was just all full steam ahead, you know. In you know,
that's the title of the episode.
That sex one, that squishy guitar one. So that one. Yes, I don't remember what. Oh, whatever. But yeah, so just kind of all kind of bled into each other, so to speak. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, so it was a touch lower than that. You know, but it just didn't really go with the song. I felt like just kind of going back to it was kind of that growing.
Okay, so based on this song, would you continue to listen to Weezer?
Oh man, I mean, maybe, well, I don't know, because it depends if all their music sounds like that. I mean, I'm definitely caught on the lyrics, and I felt like, I think also the other part is, like, for me personally, I feel like I kind of relate mm-hmm. to this, like, right now, so I'm like, oh man, like, I just, you know, found something that I'm, like, I'm going through this, so just interesting, but I don't know. I mean, I'm sure I'd probably give it a try. I mean, of course, Weezer's, now we call it Weezer's Africa, is out right now. Right. But
that actually sounds a lot more like General Weezer as well.
Yeah.
So if you like Africa, I think you'll like most of Weezer's discography. Except if you like Ratitude, you have terrible taste in music. I'm just going to say that. So to the one Ratitude fan listening to this, I'm not sorry. But yeah, I Eric, what do you? You're kind of a resident music guy. What do you think here?
You know, and this is similar to I found listening to this is similar to the again from the couple episodes ago, Tired of Sex. The bass there, I kind of gave it this word slinky. It's kind of this continuous, and it's that drone as well. You know, I guess is the other way to put it. But just that bass, I really caught on to that, you know, that it had that certain kind of a sound to it.
The bass in this album shines, you know, especially, I didn't talk about it in Tired of Sex, but that boo, boo, oh, I love that. That's the best part of the whole song. Anyway, I just had to bring that back up. But yeah, the bass especially, I think that, you know, Brian Bell, I think is the, no, Matt Sharp. Yeah, no, he really does a great job in this album, especially. So, you get anything else, you two?
I'm Googling, like, Hinder, because it almost reminds me of kind of those Hinder, Better Than Me, Lips of an Angel kind of thing, because it's still your, you know, kind of, well, not just kind of, you're insulting your girl, but you're like, oh, I don't know, stick around. It's almost like, I almost wish it had that kind of feel in that sense.
To where instead of just being negative and sad, it's like you're negging the girl intentionally? Is that what you would prefer?
I wish for more negging. No, I mean, musically wise, like kind of just that ballad sort of thing instead of,
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, this definitely has a more ballad feel. Mm-hmm.
I can see that. Well, and, you know, you can really see Pinkerton and this song, the influence on those kind of, like, emo ballads as well, you know. And, you know, this is the precursor to emo music, in my opinion. So, high school Zach, he really loved this album, that's for sure. But, so, Eric, what covers...
Well, guess what? This, as far as any kind of thing official released on a CD, seems to have no covers.
I wonder.
So even compared to Tired of Sex, that didn't have any Rockabye Babies.
So there's no other version? No other one? It's the level of humor you get with Feels Like Weezer. So,
It's no all
right. Right. Like, let's, in the hierarchy of jokes, that's definitely not in the top five, but maybe
I still won, yeah.
You still got number one. Like, that's going to be really hard to beat because of how quick it was. If you're not a writer for a TV show, you should be. Anyway, so let's get down to our ratings, I guess.
I mean, well, can I just say quickly about the cover? So I, like, immediately was like, okay, I want to hear these lyrics, but in a different kind of a different capacity. And I'll look at kind of the Rivers Cuomo acoustic as well. But I kind of also wanted to see it sort of from a female perspective. I guess it could be female perspective. I mean, same words and everything. And because, like, you know, just the idea of kind of hearing it, you know, from a man, you know, it can kind of come off potentially scarier. From a woman, obviously, you could still be like, oh, this is a crazy woman as well, but it's just a different dynamic. The only one that I really found so far, it was by the user Raina's Room. It's called No Other One, Weezer acoustic cover, Raina's Room, and it's just like a girl sitting in her room playing the guitar. But I mean, that one was mm-hmm. fine, but that was kind of the one where It was interesting to hear that one as well.
Mm-hmm. I'll have to check that one out because I'm wondering how much the message changes from, you know, depending on the perspective of female. Because
we hear these
male.
Kind of scary, you know, toxic masculinity sort of cases, and you know, to have that like, oh well, you know, you're mine, well, whatever, she's not good, but I'm keeping her, you know, versus from a woman, you know, it's almost like we kind of maybe I don't know how feminist I want to get into it, although I guess
hey,
why
go
not
for it.
Feminist analysis of the song, but yeah, just that kind of this, you know, I mean, in this cover one, it's just she's singing it, you know, straightforward about a girl, could be about a girl. If she was singing it about a guy, you know, we kind of think of the girl liking the bad boy and that's maybe more, mm-hmm. I don't want to say accepted, but we kind of internalized it a bit more, like, okay, well, he's such a bad boy, but whatever, I'll keep him. So it'll be kind of different depending who's singing the lyrics.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, we're all for a feminist reading of Pinkerton.
feminist reading of Weezer, yeah.
Well, Pinkerton especially. Because if you really listen to the whole album, there's a lot of that just inherent toxic masculinity, almost kind of like the nice guy mentality that you see. I'm really glad you brought that up because it's, you know, oh God, Rivers was probably in a dark place when he wrote this. So, but yeah, totally.
I just went through the lyrics, looking at the lyrics and switching out the pronouns. And I think it would still work. You know, it would still be singable. It's not, there aren't rhymes that are happening.
And it, you know, I think the
contingent.
The message is just changed from that. Hot take. Hot take, Alice.
Yeah. Hot.
Yeah. Eric, why don't you start us off? What's your rating for this one?
Especially because, like I said, I listened to the acoustic version. I mean, I'm not too dissatisfied with how the instrumentation is done on this versus that, say, but it is a nice take on it, to perspective to get, I think. But so I think I'll have to go with an 8 on this. I
really
like it pretty well. It's like I said, it's just that take. It's also that taking me back to. It's their his try at that for the tune of this older, I don't know, like almost like maybe like a 50s-ish. I mean, not even necessarily a rock, but even before rock was around, the more the crooners and
yeah,
the old Sinatra and
I can
other people like
I can
that.
See that. For me, this is better than Get You, so I'm gonna probably give this a 6. Out of 10, you know, the music is mostly good, I feel like, but the lyrics, I mean, it's just problematic. The whole thing is just problematic. Weezer's problematic. Pinkerton's the worst. It's not the worst album, but whatever. What about you, Alice?
Oh my gosh, I'm kind of going back and forth. I think it's like I wanted to say 1, but then the lyrics kind of bump it, you know, to another thing.
What?
I was going to say 1, but then things, you know, the lyrics kind of bumped it, but then they're so simplistic, and I don't know if I even want to say badly written because they're so touching and moving in their way as well. So I'm going to wheeze 2 times. 2 wheezes.
2 wheezes?
2 wheezes.
2 wheezes out of 10 wheezes. Wow. Is that right?
That is exactly it, yes.
I'm going to cut that out because that's terrible.
I can't wait until you do that for a 10.
This song's really good. Just pass out halfway through.
You're going
to die on us. That's how this song should have started. Every song starts with wheezing. Just like,
that's how tired I want to have you. Started, you know. Oh my goodness. Well, that's
why they call it Weezer.
That is the lowest rating we have had on the show yet. Not by much. I gave a 3 to Get You, so you know. I'm, you know, I get it. I understand.
You get 2 points for lyrics and then 1 point back, so it all added to 2.
Oh God, this is a music podcast, not a math podcast. So
I don't know.
Scrap
yeah.
it. We're not using any of this.
At least there's no pie this one.
Right.
This podcast was just for us.
The true podcast was the friends we made along the way. So Alice, what plugs you got? What do you wanna tell us about?
Let's see. Well, if you ever come to upstate New York, you could see me do some more comedy if I made you laugh in this arena. I've been on other podcasts. I think someone mentioned the Room podcast. So I was on the Room podcast. I did one about the movie 7. Fright Night one is coming out.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
fun.
Different talking ones. Yeah, I did not.
I guess.
Did not I was like on that recently either. As well, so. Every podcast is just a negative person. Yeah. Let's see what else. I just did a Monty Python podcast from the movie The Meaning of Life, right? So that kind of balances out a little bit. Wow. Yeah, I do lots of podcasts. And
I missed that one, unfortunately. Because like it was at like 2 p.m. for me.
Oh, right. Yeah, I know.
So you're a comedian. You do. Yeah, you make people laugh.
Yeah.
I prepared for that one, but like it would be homework.
Right.
But it wasn't because it was Python. Yeah, I'll watch a Python movie.
Oh, yeah. Darn it! I get to watch this fun movie.
I don't end up doing.
So, do you have any upcoming shows or anything? This is coming out early September, so you got anything booked?
Yeah, September is going to be tough. I know. Well, if you go back into the past, in August, I'm doing a Juggalo festival, so that's a thing.
I'm sorry, what?
A Juggalo festival?
That's what I thought you said.
Yeah.
So what's...
I'm not a Juggalo or anything. I'm a normal human being. But
we're not here to judge.
Okay. I just, you know, and then, I can't believe I'm going to miss Juggafest 2019. Oh, dang it. Oh, geez. So, like, are you doing comedy about ICP or?
No, just regular comedy, whatever it will be. Yeah, no, I don't know anything about ICP, no.
Oh, well, that's
I'm just
probably
beloved
for
in the community.
Well, that's exciting. Well, yeah. Have fun, I guess.
Don't know if someone wants to give me a job. I don't have a job. If this comes out in September and I don't have a job, help a girl out. I don't know. What do you plug? Your unemployment?
Great. Well, thanks for coming on, Alice.
Thank you for having me.
We'll have to have you back at some point. I really want to get... We'll have you on for Ratitude because I think we're really going to have a lot of fun with
what
that.
What about Rat?
Ratitude is a really bad album.
Oh, okay.
It's the worst. It's got a dog on the front, so you think it's going to be good. But it is not.
We can't have her do only two bad episodes.
A rat and dog
you know, songs. You know,
a rat and dog clothing.
No, it's Ratitude. Like
oh,
radical.
Not like a rat. Okay, I thought it was like
no.
Attitude, and I was excited, and now I'm.
Yeah, it's got like this little cartoon mouse. It's got ICP paint on its face and a backwards cap.
Wearing
like a long jersey.
I thought it was like a Ratatouille album or something. You know.
No, that's my other podcast, Ratitution. And we watch the movie Ratatouille every day for like months.
Right, minute by minute.
We just make food. You know, that's all we do. So thanks for coming on.
Yeah. If you want to add me,
my
Facebook is Alice Lauren. So you know, just message
me
first, people. Yeah, please message me first so I know that you're not some, you know, random creep listeners out there. But yeah, or as I said, my Twitter is AliMezh, AliMezh.
All right. Well, thanks so much, Alice. And, you know, we don't know how to end podcasts still. So
that's all right.
This is the end. Ba-da-ba-da-ba-bomp. Yeah, see, I'm not that old. I'm having a midlife crisis right now as we're recording, so...
Nah.